celebrate. Go ahead.
Well, thank you very much, and a very pleasant evening, Trinidad and Tobago, and everybody who is listening to this great radio station, Power 102.1 FM, locally, regionally, and internationally. This is Breaking the Cycle with me, Garth Christopher, right here every Monday. Yes, every Monday evening from 7 to 9 p.m. And of course, I am streaming live, very, very live on FB, that is Facebook. Live. Every time I have my show, I stream live. Ladies and gentlemen, let's get to work. You know, maybe a couple months ago, I had a protest. I had called on the Facebook people to come down in by the waterfront to help me, you know, ask and call for the resignation of Edmund Dillon, the Minister of National Security. At that time, Mr. Mark Bassant had given us a story which was contrary to what Mr. Dillon had stated. You remember on April 4th, he had to go to America to face a judge called Vistacion or something of the sort. And coming out of that whole ruling, that is with his condominium, Piper story, and Piper's niece, Esther something decided to see me, like, this man is trying to swindle my uncle. So she brought a case against him in a New York court about elder abuse and fraud and stuff like that. And so the judge gave a ruling, and it was sealed. Outside of our jurisdiction, it was sealed. But before that April 4th ruling, court matter and ruling, ladies and gentlemen, you know, we were all calling for the Prime Minister to deal with Minister Dillon. And of course, the Prime Minister, you know, he doesn't really care about us, about the people who put him there, the people who supported him, the people from Mova and Laventille. Of course, we know he cares only about the financiers of his campaign, his close friends and family. Of course, his son-in-law, who he loves more than his own two biological sons, his grandson, his daughter's child, his grandson, who he cares. I believe it seems so. More than he cares about Gad Allen's children and Christopher and his Christopher's son's children. Because, as I would have told you before, in this Christmas photo, it was his wife, his two daughters, his son-in-law, and his grandchild, his daughter's son. No picture at all of his two sons and their children. So it seems to me that he cares about a very small circle around him. And ladies and gentlemen, so as usual, he doesn't really care too much about the people, whatever we say and stuff like that. So he left Dillon there. And Faris Al-Rawi talk all kinds of nonsense about the woman, and they were grabbing for land and grabbing for property, and it's a niece, and oh Lord God, Jesus, all sorts of stuff. Faris Al-Rawi, he too has to go. And of course, you know, I said at that time, if what Mark Bossant said was true, then Edmund Dillon had to vacate office, and if not, he had to be fired immediately. He had to be fired now. And I was featured in the Express newspapers. Of course, I was talking to the minister, to the opposition leader, and they put it in the newspapers and stuff like that. Of course, maybe to link me to Kamala Prasad Bisesa and the UNC, because you know they believe that I'm a UNC and stuff like that. All right. So all of that happened. And there was a guy on Facebook. Well, of course, he's absent now. He has taken it off. I don't know if he's on Facebook and a different name. And many of you would remember Michael Tudor. He said all sorts of nasty, stinking, dirty things about Mr. Piper's niece. And there is another guy who called Anselm Lubon. He and all said a nasty stuff about the man's niece, and oh, who is what and who doing this and stuff like that, and oh, he was championing the cause of Mr. Dillon, and oh, when the truth comes out. And he even posted a video, and those of you who have the video that not Michael Tudor but Anselm Lubon posted about Edmund Dillon, and he was saying how he has integrity and stuff, send it to me. Somehow I lost it, but if you have it, if you know what I'm talking about, you can send it to me, because I want it back. I want to save it. I should have saved it in the first place. I was looking for it to post it today, ladies and gentlemen. Now based on the Sunday newspapers report, I'm talking about Sunday, Newsday, June 24th, that's yesterday, Newsday, and we also have The Guardian. Dillon give up condo to original owner for $10. That's The Guardian's story. And the Newsday, Dillon returns New York apartment to owner $10. So I know the love to put people in court. I'm referring to articles on the newspapers, because I have no court clothes and I have no money. So you know, don't try to sue me. Don't try to sue me. I have no money at all. All right. But ladies and gentlemen, As my good friend Kingsley will say, I am only asking questions. I am only asking questions, ladies and gentlemen. Again, if this Sunday Newsday story, June 24th, 2018, and this Sunday Guardian story of Sunday, June 24th, 2018, if these two stories are not true, then I would expect Edmund Dillon to sue the newspapers, sue the Newsday, sue the Guardian. And if these stories are true, I expect the Prime Minister to fire, immediately dismiss Mr. Edmund Dillon, ladies and gentlemen. I am asking questions and making a statement. I am not accusing anybody of any wrongdoing. But I remember Minister Dillon issued on the Ministry of National Security's letterhead that he was not found to be in any wrongdoing. Ladies and gentlemen, I simply ask the question, if your good friend, 88 year old, Neville Piper gifted you a luxury apartment or a condominium, and you accepted it, what the hell are you doing selling it back to him for $10? I am just asking questions. I don't understand this, ladies and gentlemen. And I'm going to open the lines very early in the game for those of you who understand to tell me, explain it to me. Something is wrong with my blockhead. Something is wrong with my blockhead tonight, because I cannot understand that. And I am going to open the lines for you to call. And for those of you on Facebook, please help me to understand this matter. I have a simple question. If Mr. Piper, 88 years old, gifted you an apartment or an entire condominium, and you accepted it, how come, on what basis, after somebody accused you of elderly abuse, only after the fact that they accused you and brought you to court on elderly abuse and fraud, only after that you decided suddenly to sell for $10 the person who gifted you that apartment or condominium? Ladies and gentlemen, listen to me. I don't know if I'm going senile, cuckoo. I don't know. I'm only 50. I don't know what's wrong with my, but I can't understand that. I'm going to open the lines. 222 talk. 222-8255. Early in the game. 222 talk. 222-8255. I want you to tell me. Explain that to me, ladies and gentlemen. Tell me if it makes sense. If it doesn't make sense, tell me I'm stupid. I don't understand why you think I'm stupid. Why I should understand, ladies and I don't understand it. 222 talk, 222-8255, 612 talk, 612-8255. Get in on the conversation. And those of you on Facebook, I want you to share this video. Share it to everybody. Share it. Make it go viral. Let it go live. Let Stuart Young, send Stuart Young and them. Send it on their page. Send it on Faris Al-Rawi's page. Send it on the opposition page. Send it on Rowley's page. If you know them, send it on them. All the groups that you are in, send it, ladies and gentlemen. I don't understand this. I do not understand it. And ladies and gentlemen, you can say what you want about Kamala Prasad Bisesa. You could say she had a corrupt government. You could say she used to drink White Oak. She used to drink Grey Goose. She used to drink vodka. You could say that. I don't know them to be true, but you could say that. You could say she let Rambachan and Munilal and Ram Logan and them thief all the money. You could even say that. That is not my argument. My argument is this could have never, ever, ever happened under the prime ministership of Kamala Prasad Bisesa. Never. She fire man for jokey thing. This could have never happened. Ladies and gentlemen, what the hell did we vote in Rowley for? What did we vote in Rowley for, ladies and gentlemen? And this man, this Edmund Dillon, he has the gall to go in parliament. Jesus Christ, something is wrong with these people. Lord God, what kind of country are we running? What kind of country are we living in? We need change. Ladies and gentlemen, we need change. This could never be a real country. Never be a real country, man. What is this? Could you tell me? What the hell is this? What is this, ladies and gentlemen? Huh? The Prime Minister ain't fired Dylan as yet. Let us forget for a moment that Edmund Dylan is the worst ever Minister of National Security. But look at this matter. Hello, good evening.
Hello.
Hello, good evening.
Hello, sir.
Yes, good evening.
I can hardly hear you.
I'm hearing you.
Sir?
I am hearing you. Listen to me on the telephone.
Yes, Dylan has to go, but after duly elected election, he can't go now. He's elected member of parliament.
Oh, I see.
What stats do you have to prove that he's the worst minister ever? What is the stat?
Okay.
Tell me something. What happened with other ministers that didn't happen with him?
Okay.
Tell me.
What else do you have to say? Do you have anything else to say about that?
No, I think that you should be factual when making a comment. We have to look at the population.
Okay.
And I just feel that the poor, how are you paying for this 2 hours on the radio?
Oh, I see, okay.
And you're so poor.
All right. Okay, thank you very much.
I can't understand it.
Thank you very much. Enough of you. Enough of you. Hello, good evening.
Good evening to you, Dad.
Hey, what's up, my brother?
Good evening to my dad. Hello?
Yes, my friend, good evening.
Yes, I know. I know where Mr. Steve.
Yes.
Once a good evening to you, Gat, and good evening to Magdaddy. Is Magdaddy there, right?
No. It's family. Family.
And,
It's family there.
Yes, I'm our family. Good evening to you, family.
Hey, family, what's up?
Gat, this evening, I hear your spirit. I hear your mood. You are asking the people of this country, it's time to stand up. It's time to put up your hands. It's time for me to ask for good governance in this country. Because when we see that a government who do not care for the people and care for certain type of people in this country, we ask where our country is going. God, this Minister of National Security, God, I'm saying that he's not the man for the job. He's not the man for the job. God, you know something? This man got over $24 billion in the last 3 years, and I asked him, where is our $24 billion? He got $24 billion. Where is our money, Dylan? Where is our money, Dylan? Where is our $24 billion? All you get in that ministry to play with, and today. You want to see things and hide things from the public? And $24 billion, I ask you, we are asking you, give account for that $24 billion. Because God, crime out of control. The police station have no jeep station marching on this country. Police out of control in this country. But the Ministry of National Security get 24 billion dollars in the last 3 years, and we have a man going into parliament and trying to do what he learned in the army. He want to bully an MP. He want to tell the opposition that who represent over 400,000 people in this country, plus the whole country of all. You telling people hush up their mouth, do not speak and ask questions. Why did you stand up to tell us you're a bomb specialist? I ask, we do not need a bomb specialist. We do not need a soldier. We do not need a soldier as a Minister of National Security. We need somebody who's concerned about young people getting killed and blood in this country. What is your plan, Dylan? What is the government plan to shut? Because, fact, we have to be real. The government, my thing, cannot stop the crime. But crime is out of control. Crime is out of control. And when crime is out of control and a government cannot have no handle on it, all hell will go loose in a country. And today, the government do not have a handle on the crime. They continue blaming. You know something, Jack? They blame, in 2010, they blame Samlal for every killing in the country. 2010, 11, 15. to be in 2018 to take that. You know something? They continue blaming Kamala for crime. So over 9 years in this country, Dr. Keith Rowdy blames Kamala for crime. Today, he is the prime minister.
Kingsley.
After three years in power.
Kingsley.
Yes.
Dylan sold a condominium or an apartment in a condominium for $67 TT.
Where we money got
$67 TT. And here who he sold it to? To the man who gifted it to him. Let us make sense out of that. And when the newspapers, call him to get a response, ladies and gentlemen, he's not answering. The prime minister said, Edmond Dillon only telling him he had to go away on some personal business. And he know nothing. I wonder what is the prime minister saying about this? I wonder if the prime minister called him and say, Edmond, what is this about? Did
God,
this really happen?
God, nothing to say, God. God, you will not say nothing, God. Because, God, this is... You hear me, God?
Yeah.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
I'm hearing. God, go ahead.
This government, right, called five no confidence motion against the former government, against Jack Warner, Gary Griffith, Emmanuel George, and the two the names slipped me. They call five no confidence motion against them. This government did not give the former government one day to govern this country. Every Monday morning, they blame the UNC for crime. Every Tuesday, they hold a press conference, blame Jack Warner, blame the UNC. The whole 90,000 African people, they continue blaming. And I cannot believe crime is going on today in this country.
You see,
the Prime Minister.
Hi, brother, thank you.
Young.
Thank you, my friend.
It's Edmund Dillon.
We need to take a break. We need
blame
to.
The opposition. Blame Kamala. Blame Kamala.
Thank you.
What is all your plan?
We need to take a break.
We are fed up because, God, there are three people sitting down. In the Ministry of National Security.
All right, we need to take a break.
It's time for the bargain of the year at Farbinger Expo. Now closing on July 2nd. Yes, it's the final extension of Farbinger Expo, located at the White Tent opposite Medford Gas Station, Shogunas. Massive sale now on. Everything selling up to 80% off. Spend $1,000 or more on links or credit card for a chance to spin to win up to $500 instantly. We cater for the entire family. Ready-made garments, handicraft, footwear, jewelry, furniture, decorations, religious items, and much more available all under one roof. Don't miss out on this opportunity to visit the best of the best. Farbinger Expo, final extension, closing on July 2nd, 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Entry is absolutely free. Check us out today.
I'm Lester Sidlaw, inviting you to join me every Tuesday and Thursday, 10 p.m. to 11 p.m.
We have another break, but we will take that about half past.
Slow gospel music. A program designed.
Cool, no problem.
I have
two guests coming in though.
You have two guests coming in.
Yeah, two local government.
Okay, well, we could take.
Yeah, you just tell me. No, they are here already. I will bring them in a little bit.
Okay, we could take the second break and take a club.
Yeah.
We have a whole hour with them.
Yeah, no problem.
We made the coming before.
Yeah. I think they are already here.
Because it's a short break. And
the freshest meats. They serve healthy, affordable meals every day. Visit their in-store bakery for all your freshly baked bread and more. Great service
and variety. In line by Jed, by Watchmen. This. Yeah. Garmin, but
the East-West Corridor Food Champions, which is at one at the Fable Village, Santa Cruz.
It's time for the Bargain of the Year at Favindia Expo. Now closing on July 2nd. Yes, it's the final extension of Favindia Expo, located at the White Terrace at Metro Station Showrunners. Massive sales go on. Everything selling up to 80% off. Spend $1,000 or more on links or credit card for a chance to spin to win up to $500 instantly. We cater for the entire family. Don't miss out on this opportunity to visit the best of the best.
I was at 93 for a while, and I was constant mangina.
Cool. Power 102 invites you to divine inspiration.
Are you there, buddy?
To the way, the truth, and the light. Be inspired by powerful music, inspirational preachers, and transformational testimonials. Divine Inspiration, Mondays to Thursdays, 9 p.m. to midnight, on Power 102 FM, and streaming live via the Power 102 app. Tune in to Divine Inspiration and be transformed.
Well, welcome back, and thank you very much for staying tuned to Power 102.1 FM, and you're listening to Breaking the Cycle with me, Garth Christopher, right here every Monday evenings, 7 to 9 p.m. Ladies and gentlemen, I have in studio two individuals, a candidate and a party representative, and I will introduce them in a little bit. And I'm also expecting a UNC candidate. Well, I have the PAP candidate for Barataria, and he will introduce himself. And I am also expecting the UNC candidate for Belmont. We'll wait and see, all right? But the PEP candidate for Barataria is here, and we will get him in on the conversation in a little bit. But let's go back to the lines for a little while as I continue the conversation on Dylan. Edmund Dylan. And I don't understand, gentlemen. I don't understand, and listeners, why would I, after accepting an apartment or a condominium from a friend, accepted it. A few months later, I decided, after a court matter, I am now going to sell that individual who gifted me the apartment that I accepted. I'm going to now sell that individual, that very said apartment, for $10. I don't understand. The callers are going to help me. Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening, guys.
Good evening. Yes. Hello? Yes, yes, I'm hearing you loud and clear.
Good evening, and how are you?
Well, I'm fine, thank you.
Good, great to hear. God, how do you think Mr. Manning would have described Mr. Dylan's behavior in the parliament on Friday?
Well, you could tell me.
Hello?
Yeah, you could tell me.
Do you think he would have described him as a raging bull, too?
Or
a man totally out of control?
Maybe.
That's how he behaved. That's how it sounded to me. That's how it looked to me.
Okay.
And I was looking at him.
All right.
I was very disappointed in his behavior. I never expected that behavior from Mr. Dylan.
What did he say? What did he say in particular that caused you to see him and as a raging bull? What, he started behaving?
He started off in a very erratic manner, and then he shouted across the floor to the Member of Parliament for Princeton, shut up!
Oh, I see. Okay, yes. That was very raging.
That was not... And then he said, in 1990, he checked every car, every this, every that, because he is a bomb expert. Wasn't he being paid to do that?
Okay.
At that time?
Well, I would think so.
He's being paid now to be the Minister of National Security. He was being paid to do that.
Yeah. All right.
And then ask the question, which one of them over their children is in what's the effect that is in the defense force?
Okay.
You know which one of them over there? No respect for the opposition at all.
Okay.
As usual.
Thank you very much.
Yes, okay, God. You have a good night.
Okay, thank you, and same to you. Ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you something. You are safer introducing, gentlemen, you are safer introducing your young, beautiful wife to Edmund Dillon. You are not safe to introduce your grandmother or your great-grandmother or great-grandfather to him. You are safer introducing your young, beautiful wife. He will not target her. Well, you have a problem if you introduce that to the Prime Minister. But Edmund Dillon, do not introduce your grandmother or great-grandmother or great-grandfather to him. He is going to target them, ladies and gentlemen. Hello, good evening.
Wow, and God, I am waiting to ask the candidate in the next hour some very serious questions. I will be prepared to face the public by asking questions. But God, when you see that the opposition call a motion of no confidence against the Minister of National Security, and that the last Friday there in Parliament there was a serious debate on crime, on young people getting killed in the country, and when you can see that the government of the day ain't coming no solution to prove the point that look, we solving crime, look, we have a plan. They asked for the anti-gang bill. We still see people continue getting killed in our streets. Overnight, this tomorrow, when we wake up, we might hear 5 people dead, right? We are seeing that our borders remain open. Our borders in lockdown. We are seeing that Coast Guard and Customs officers is being held with all...
Kingsley.
Our police service
Kingsley is
in a mess.
Kingsley, why is the Prime Minister... Kingsley, why is the Prime Minister not firing Edmund Dillon? Why... Kingsley, forget a crime. Forget a crime. Kingsley.
Why are you not taking care of... our borders.
Kingsley, forget that now. Forget that now. Thank you. Forget that now. I don't want to hear nothing about no crime and no borders and no murders. I don't want to hear about that now, Kingsley. I want to hear about Dillon and Piper and $10 and condominium and Rowley and how Rowley dealing with that. That is what I want to talk about tonight. I want to hear about Faris Al-Rawi when he came out and defended Dillon. And talk about he spoke to Dillon's lawyers. That is what I want to talk about. Not about open borders and how many murders. I don't want to deal with that now. We could deal with that tomorrow, please God, another time. But not now. Hello, good evening.
Good evening.
Yes.
You know, don't waste a lot of time. This was the only door that was open to protect Mr. Dillon from the litigation and truthfulness of the courts of the United States of America. And that's it, very simply. He had no other defense. And this was the one worked out for him by his legal counsel in the United States in collusion with the legal counsel here, in collusion with the legal counsel and judiciary here in Trinidad and Tobago. It was the only door open to present litigation that may not go in this field.
All right.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
I like that.
Ladies and gentlemen, something is wrong with our governance system. We are in a dangerous place. As I've told you before, Trinidad and Tobago in now start to rotten. We now start to smell stink. Ladies and gentlemen, we need change. I propose constitution reform. That's the only thing. Ladies and gentlemen, one more call and then I'm going to introduce our guests. Hello, good evening.
Good evening, Mr. Christopher.
What's happening, my friend?
Okay. Good evening. This is family in the house.
Hey, family, good evening.
Good evening. Well, you see, well, we know Dr. Rowling touching down that 10-foot pole. But when I read a Gail Alexander report on what happened in the parliament and outside the parliament on the Saturday Guardian, and they say only 8 people came from Dillon constituency point 14 to support him. They say the people already abandoned him too. But God, the first motion in the Senate dealing with the Guardian's passage business and the Synanon. I remember outside the parliament and there were people supporting communities to support Synanon.
Yes, of course.
And he nobody like he. Nobody in common to support the one. Well, as soon as it's point 14, it's library, right? He's a library man or point 14? MP for library?
One of them. So one of them PNM seat and them up the road.
Yeah, but I think it's point 14.
Yeah, yeah, by your partner, Mark.
But the Prime Minister still holds on to his for their life. And that debate, the government side was so weak. I hear a man said talk about some woman's shoes and all kind of thing. I understand what I'm saying. But you talk about the man condo?
By $10, by $67, $80, by...
$10?
The man sell a condo, you know, boy, for $67, you know, boy.
But he's trying to make it look like the man and give it back, boy. You understand?
Yeah, but I understand that $10 is just the transfer fees.
Yeah. He can give it back, he can get on a false return or something that he said, because the man called momentarily ago and tried to say that is the only legal way to get it done. You understand? But getting, if it's a PNM minister, could get gifts. If it's any other minister or any political party, give his bribe. Give his this and give his that, integrity commission, this, that, and the other.
Yeah,
but. Did the man get a gift? And that is it. Glad you locked on listening.
All right, buddy. Thank you very much.
Question and answer now. We got.
We need to take a break. We'll be right back. My pendant. Christoph, right?
Yeah, C-H-R-I-S-T-O-P. Christoph.
C-H-R-I-S-T.
Power 102 invites you to divine inspiration.
S-A-M.
Your guide to the way, the truth, and the light. Be inspired by powerful music, inspirational teachers, and transformational testimonials. Divine Inspiration, Mondays to Thursdays, 9 p.m. to midnight on Power 102 FM, and streaming live.
Divine
Inspiration, and be transformed.
It's time for the bargain of the year at
Farbinger Expo.
And you are the what? Within the party, you are the major financier.
Right, I wish. Well, for Christoph, I'm his campaign manager.
Okay, right, good.
For a chance to spend to win up to $500 instantly. Weekly support the entire family. Ready-made garments.
But within the party, I'm a media director.
Furniture, decorations, religious items, and much more available all under one roof. Don't miss out on this opportunity to visit the best of the best. Farbinger Expo, final extension, closing on July 2nd, 11 a.m. to 9 p.m. Entry is absolutely free. Check us out today.
Your car is for you to enjoy, and many victims of car theft feel helpless at that dreadful moment, not knowing if their car will ever be recovered.
There's madness going on in this country, boys.
Why matters any word? God, it's not the word, brother. I'm sorry. I spent 25 years outside. Come back home to see a place that I leave today as a whole that it look the same, you know. But hear what? Everything else, as in people?
Visit them on Facebook at Air Support GPS.
We had to bring change right
there. For peace.
ML Ballpark presents the Ballpark World Cup.
I told her, take a look at all the candidates now, man. The PEP candidate for Barataria.
Yes, Bhattacharya, Bhattacharya, coming to bring change, Bhattacharya, real change, not no jokey change. And you want to make sure it's real change? Come, be a part of the party. Come and see for yourself. Insert yourself in the PEP to ensure we take the country where it needs to go. Real, not joke, real.
As you said, I encourage you all to add your voices to the conversation, because I don't know everything. I need to know what you all want done. That's my job. So work with us.
At Ballpark TP on Facebook and Instagram.
Munchkins ice cream. Munchkins ice cream.
Yeah, cool.
Munchkins ice cream. Munchkins good for one.
Delicious.
It's better bite.
I want some.
It's best when we in a line with me and with you.
Come on.
I'll see you and see candidate.
Munchkins ice cream.
Real good.
So creamy.
Yeah.
Munchkins ice cream.
Munchkins. Gotta have it today.
Yes, welcome back to Breaking the Cycle with me, Garth Christopher, right here on Power 102.1 FM every Monday evening from 7 to 9 p.m. And of course, I told you, we're going to pause on Dylan for a little while and we're going to get into the party and the politics and the by-election, the July 16th by-election. We just have a few, let's say about a couple... less than 3 weeks now. Yeah, less than 3 weeks, yeah. Or approximately 3 weeks.
Exactly 3 weeks.
Yeah. Exactly 3 weeks. And we have in studio the PEP candidate, the PEP candidate for Bhattacharya, Mr. Christoph Samlal, and his campaign manager, Mr. Anthony Defoe. And Mr. Defoe is also the media director, or maybe one of the media directors of the PEP, and the PEP is the
Progressive Empowerment Party.
The Progressive Empowerment Party.
Yes.
Gentlemen, welcome to Breaking the Cycle.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks for having us. Good night, listeners.
Let's get right into it, into the campaign. Mr. Samlal, why a young man like you've decided to put yourself in this whole politics mess, knowing that people tell you two things I don't argue, politics and religion. So if they don't argue that, I don't know if they want to get involved in it. I mean, how are your parents feeling about it? What did they say to you?
Well, they've been encouraging so far because they know it's something that I'm very passionate about. I've been spending most of my spare time trying to help as much as I could. So they know that this would be the opportunity for me to actually help as much people as I could by giving them a voice and getting what they need done.
Okay, but are there other ways that you can help the people?
Well, like I said, I've been very active in terms of feeding the homeless, trying to find jobs for them, trying to help them get on their own 2 feet and sustain themselves. But in terms of reach, in terms of finances, and in terms of power, there's only so much I can do as an ordinary citizen.
But what kind of power does local government has? I mean, local government really has no power. You would hear them saying that. I mean, as a matter of fact, it's not even enshrined in our national constitution.
Right. So what they really are in charge of is everything that falls out of the purview of the ministries itself. So in terms of social programs, yes, there's the Ministry of Social Development. But we can have a very active role in setting up like homework centers to help the students work their way up, instead of being doomed to mediocrity based on where they live and not having the resources available. So in terms of providing resources for them to help themselves up, local government does have a part in terms of that.
Are you a resident of Bhattacharya?
Well, I live in the Sawa Bhattacharya region, but I'm actually on the Santa Cruz Old Road. So I spend my day within the Sawa Bhattacharya region throughout my life, you know?
Because I have a policy, you know, I think, I'm formulating a constitution reform paper, as it were. Just a little thing, you know. I ain't that scholarly. Anyhow, waste of time being so scholarly, because there are certain people in Parliament who have all kind of PhD.
Hey, doctor's degree, you know,
all kind of damn thing. All of them went the NAPS. They went all kind of them prestige schools. And then one day their parents shame on them.
Listen, man, I feel like I know for a fact I can put my 10-year-old there and she can do a whole lot better.
So what is education good for in our country? I mean, do we? It's a whole different story, yes, partners. Let me stick to the local government issues. Yes, you understand me? You know, but I have this idea that and this feeling and this belief that if you're running for an area, you should be living there. How do you feel about that?
Well, while I understand why you are concerned with that, where exactly do you draw the line of living in the area?
Well, within the
district itself?
The district or the constituency, if you're going for local elections.
So if I live one street above the boundary, mm-hmm. do you think that's a fair reason to disqualify me for representing the people
that's a reasonable argument, but it is what it is in terms of the
configuration. No, but that's why I say I live there and I spend my everyday time there. Mm-hmm. So in terms of telling me I live there, I consider that I live there. Sawa and Baratara is home, not just my house.
So your where you live falls within constituency of Sawa Baratara.
Yeah, and within the municipality. Because local government is divided by
municipality. Not the municipality, because the municipality is far and wide, all of Blanchard shares.
But that's what decides for local government.
Right, I understand.
It's not related to...
I understand, but I said... But are you living within the constituency of Sawa Barataria?
Well, I was, and then up until the last election, the boundary moved. And
the boundary moved. Right. Okay, fine.
So
okay.
I fall now in St. Anne's.
All right, but you went to school in
San Juan. Yeah.
In Sawa Barataria. Okay, that's fair enough, you know. I can understand
my everyday life, my family is well established there in terms of business and the church.
Good. So cool. Fair enough.
Well grounded.
I cool with
area.
That. But right. I have this policy. You can't tell me you live in Coover. Oh, Goodwood Park,
yeah.
Or Tobago, and they want to come and represent me in Nova.
Right, exactly.
When water gone,
we believe that. Yeah, that's exactly what we want to do. Right. We want to ensure the MPs come from that constituency, as well as like you said, within the polling districts or and such. We do believe the individual should be residing within those areas directly. So they know what's going on as far as for fact, because they're there.
Right.
I do want to come back to a little point you had brought earlier, a question you had asked. We know that local government is not much happening there. I will tell you this. The PEP wants to bring real change from the ground up. We can't start in one area or focus on one place and think it's going to be fixed. Trinidad is broken everywhere. Everything is broken. Nothing works. What we want to do is to be able to have the people in the positions that is able to actually provide the level of service that the citizen is supposed to have. Because at the end of the day, we have to remember, when we talk MPs, they don't wake up one afternoon, throw a suit on, and walk into the parliament. It's the people that put them there. And the point to that is that their responsibility is to ensure betterment for the people. So you're talking about, we have had independence 50 plus years. You're talking about 11 administrations. You would think for a rich, resource-rich nation like Trinidad and Tobago, not just with our oil and gas, but with our tourism, which could have been, with our agriculture, which could have been, as well as our local manufacturing, which could have been. But if you look at the environment that we have right now, again, we talk about the one percenters and all these different things. It's created the way that it is right now, because we cannot have 1.5 million people, 1.4 million people, and spend $60 billion on an annual basis. And we are not first world.
Gentlemen, I and the population at home and abroad would have heard a lot of these conversations emanating and coming from brand new political parties
mm-hmm.
in Trinidad and Tobago.
Correct.
And when they got the opportunity, they just didn't do it. I mean, we manifesto after manifesto,
yeah,
campaign platform after campaign platform.
But what's the difference, though?
COP.
What's the difference between the COP,
new
MSG?
Politics,
right?
New politics, and they got a chance. Duke Aran, what did he do? What is going to make you different?
What is making us different is that we are not a part of the one percenters. We are not a part of the PNM, the UNC, any of the corruption, any of the links, any of the connections, and all this underworld business and underhand business. The PEP is not engaging in this whatsoever. We're stepping on everyone's toes, because at the end of the day, you have to understand, we are dealing with a nation that is broken in every sense. Every sense. Everything has to be revamped. I heard the caller before had spoken about closing down the borders. Yes, we agreed to close down the borders, and they've been talking about closing down the borders for how long? How long have the administration talk about closing down the borders? We talk about we have rogue police officers doing underhanded business within the service. Administration after administration, and to this day, we still cannot have a system in place where we are able to purge our security services, from Coast Guard to Army to Customs to Immigrations to Police Service, you name it. The point of the matter is, God.
How do you propose to purge them?
Well, our plan, really, we've been in talks with foreign agencies, and again, we have support.
So you're going to bring a foreign country and say that here?
Well, it's not a matter of bringing us. No.
To find out all of our business, all of our secrets.
No, it's not a matter. Not at all. That is not the case. We are, again, not UNC or PNM. We are PEP. And PEP is forward thinkers. We have a tremendous
think tank. So you're telling me that you're going to bring in foreign people? Foreign.
We're getting
from developed countries across the world. Knowing how they function.
Right.
They are big fishes. The big fish eat the little fish, and the little fish eat shit. Okay. You're talking about we're a little fish.
Right.
You bring in a big fish inside of here to know everything about us. And you're telling me that they are not going to use that to their advantage and to our disadvantage?
Well, hold on.
Our national security.
Don't wait. But don't we, as the citizens of this country, don't we, as the big business people, the corporate companies, and the politician, knows what's going on in Trinidad? It's not to say we don't know drugs is passing through. It's not to say we don't know there are certain connections with certain people that is affiliated in certain things.
So when they help you to solve your problem, your crime problem. And by the way, they have all the OPVs, they have all the national security wall around there, but cocaine does pass through all over to go into America and right. to these places. All right?
Because it's a much larger country with a much larger border.
Well, guess what, right? God?
Because most of it actually passes.
But they have a lot. But they have a lot more money, and they are very much more organized, and they have a lot of history. You understand? Naval, this, da-da-da-da-da-da-da.
But God, you have Mexico that is bordering America with its own border by land, and Mexico chooses to pass drugs through Trinidad to go to North America.
Right, so
this is just to show how porous our borders are and how corrupted our security services is.
So who is, after you clean up, who is going to man and ensure
that it remains
sanitized?
Right. It's a several prong event initiative, Garth, because aside from bringing in foreign agencies to assist us in cleaning the police service and security services of Trinidad and Tobago, because we need to identify who the rogue officers or the people who are in high office or specific offices, public offices, that is misbehaving in
but Scotland Yard brought Scotland Yard came
yeah,
and
but again
and
we
run
hold on, Chris, because I want to deal with this. The reason why I want to deal with this is because we are talking about the entities before, which was the PNM, the UNC, or whichever administration that there was before the PEP, before today. Trinidad has made history. There's a new light for Trinidad, for Trinbagonians, simply because they have an administration that is not tainted in any way and is filled with fellow citizens that is not of the political cloth. These are citizens that want change. Regardless of all the corruption, we have seen what the corruption has done, Garth. We have seen where our country is heading.
Venezuela is a perfect example to where this is where our destiny is if we choose to continue going down the road and give a blind eye. Listen, I have no desire to be in politics, you know, between you and I. I'd rather be on Maracas eating shark and bake with my family or with my friends. But at the end of the day, I've seen my father sit and wait for change. I've seen my grandfather sit and wait for change. They're both 6 feet under the ground. Did they get changed, Garth? No. We are sitting down reading and hearing about people getting raped in the savannah, calling for help, and nine men come and help the rapists. We're hearing about rapes taking place in police stations, and the victim was not able to have recourse on that for what, 10, 15 years later? I mean, we have people being arrested and have not even been charged, but is sitting in a jail for 5 years that if they had pleaded guilty, Garth, they would have been outside already with their families. My point is, God,
how are you going to deal with that?
This is it. It's a multi-prong effect that needs to take place. Everything almost has to happen at the same time, but it has to happen controlled. We're not just going to explode the country and just break everything down.
So are you suggesting that we get rid of all the police?
It's not a matter of getting rid of the police.
I want to know. Explain to us how it's going to happen.
Well, you know what? Again, we may not even have enough time to explain because it's
we have time.
It's
at
no
least,
take my words. No, brother, we don't. I could give you a short version of it. But if you want details, Trinidad and Tobago, you want greater detail, come down to Stanmore Avenue. It's the head office for the Progressive Empowerment Party at noon.
You have a whole hour. You have an opportunity.
Don't worry. Well, we will work the hour. We will work the hour, most definitely. And if you want to put focus on this area, yes, we can. Now, you're talking about cleaning the police service and security services, as well as how are we going to pacify having to fill the void that is going to be created. One, we are creating a system where right off the bat, we are starting with new initiatives as in training, as in protocols for our police officers and security services, such as drug testing and polygraph testing and so on. And that's just the scratch of the surface.
So we don't have that as yet?
What, is it being used?
We don't have mandatory polygraph
testing. Is it being used, Garth?
We don't have
mandatory polygraph testing. Is it? Licensing officers, police officers, customs officers.
But hold on, wait.
People
God,
of important God. Values that could be highly corrupted. They are the ones need to be regularly polygraphed, as well as have their finances declared upon getting a job, and regularly controlled and managed. So when bribes show up, when somebody end up with a condo on the name out of the blue, they have to account for that.
Yeah, give me a polygraph.
We need to hold these people accountable for everything that we can notice.
Don't we have institutions that are guarding those things?
Does the institutions work?
Well, how are you going to ensure that they work, and who are you going to put
It needs to be purged.
How are you purging them?
But again, you're seeing how are you purging them? With the purging process, we have to have something to fill the void. This is what I'm saying to you.
Sure.
And again, I can't go into full detail as to how that mechanism works.
Start the process, gentlemen.
But again,
Start explaining to us because you're complaining.
But Garth, I'm not a professional within the field.
You all have been complaining about media not covering you.
Right.
I brought you here. You have hours. You have a whole hour. Start to explain to the population how you're going to achieve these nice, lofty goals and ambitions. You are a very ambitious party.
Yes, we are.
You're new. You're fresh. In my mind, you are the third force in Trinidad and Tobago. All right? You have an opportunity. Start to explain to the people. Because it's good to say, we want to do this. We want to do this. We're going to do that. Explain to us how. And for me, I want to know how long it's going to take.
Right.
But you don't have to answer me how long it's going to take now. But start the process. Explain to us how. You're going to build a national security wall.
Maritime.
Correct.
Right. A maritime wall.
Right.
Explain to the population who are listening locally,
beautiful,
regionally, and internationally.
Not a problem.
You mean
a security
by
wall.
A security wall, very briefly.
No problem.
And how you're going to build it.
All right. This is how it's going to work. The project is that they are derelict oil barges that's out into the ocean. We propose between 6 to 8 barges, 3 miles out of our coastline surrounding Trinidad and Tobago. These barges are going to be outfitted with police, Coast Guard, customs, immigration, the security forces, basically. And what this is going to do, as well as with the 360-degree radar, it's a stop and search engine that we are trying to create here. There's nothing to leave or come into the shores of Trinidad and Tobago without being stopped and searched.
So you don't want the OPVs?
We are going to have OPVs.
Right,
we are going to have, on these same platforms, you're going to have attack helicopters, you're going to have attack boats, you're going to have a detention area within there, again, because you're going to have facilities for immigration, customs. You're going to have the entire ensemble on each barge. And again, it's about having 24/7, 365 days a year surveillance. People have to work. End of story.
When you do that, and you stop all the drugs.
And the guns.
And the guns.
The resources will be placed on the island.
How you feel sure that economy will really work? Because you know the underground economy, you know the underground economy and the drug economy is responsible for a lot of money floating within the within the economy.
Yes, how much of that money reaches to the ground
of
in the economy?
Of course.
Yes,
you have 1.4 million people not seeing that money.
Correct.
If you're talking about the fellas on the block selling the little weed, 10 piece and 20 piece, here we're going, and I have a message for the fellas on the same block. The PEP proposes to decriminalize marijuana. So, what we want to do is empower our people. There's a huge medicinal use for cannabis in the world.
Yeah, but them fellas who's smoking right now, them don't want no weed for no medicine. Them want weed
no, but
brain,
at the end of the day, the same way you say weed for the brain, this is all taboo, because the fact of the matter where weed is concerned, as you'd like to call it, the point to that is we sit and we drink alcohol, we get high, we kill people on the street, we have legal cigarettes, and on the pack, Surgeon General saying, you're smoking this on your own risk, it's poisoning, you know? But here, what is legal?
Right, but right? Growing marijuana for medicinal purposes is all fine and good and stuff like that. But I'm just saying that the weed that these guys on the block want is not, they want weed to smoke.
To smoke?
Yeah.
Right.
So why can't we control marijuana the same way we control tobacco and alcohol?
I'm not questioning that. I'm just saying, okay, fine, but you know, how you propose to make this whole thing work? I mean, what, you're given acreages of land for people to
cultivate marijuana. Correct, yes. Yes, we have the best soil in the world. We have the best.
You're going to export,
correct, to pharmaceutical companies and agencies that is using this for their medicinal products that
they give to the world.
And this is a $1 billion industry. Yeah?
But do you feel doing that and looking at that as an industry? I mean, when it's being legalized other parts of the
yes,
world. Do you think it is going to be, I mean, a lucrative industry?
Yes, it will be.
Why? Why will it be so lucrative when everybody would be producing
again, it will not. Listen, we produce the best cocoa. We produce the best coffee. We produce the best sugar. Our soil is the most fertile soil you can find in the planet. And again, Garth, listen, the propaganda that's been giving our people here for over 50 plus years since the Queen leave these shores, the point of the matter is that they simply want to keep the population down. The PEP wants to empower the people. We'll give you the information. And again, the day we get into office, we celebrate true independence. The people of this country will celebrate true independence for our citizens, because at the end of the day, first law that the PEP wants to put into place is recall, which means to say the PEP in office would be the first party, if the people choose, to get rid of any minister, or down to the prime minister for that matter, if it's Mr. Alexander. My point is, the people have the right to do that, and we are putting that as law, because you can't hire a man who working for you and he dictating a pace and he doing wrong in your place. The parliament is there due to the people. If the people don't put a representative there for any constituency, the parliament doesn't exist. It doesn't. So the purpose of people within the parliament, that 41 seats, in any given time, from the time that Queen left the shores, we were supposed to be gaining betterment each and every time an administration came in, because each administration was supposed to try to outdo the next. Each administration was supposed to try to bring betterment for the nation. 1.4 million people, there is nobody in New York City, Manhattan, we ain't talking Queens, Brooklyn, Staten Island, upstate New York. Manhattan is 8 million people there.
So in what?
And they are managing themselves great. We have 1.5 and we have hemorrhaging.
In what space of time, so do you think we will if a PEP government, if a PEP party were to be voted into government, what space of time should you expect?
Do you think that we can aspire to first world status or close to?
No, we'll take it
one step at a time.
To erect this national security world.
We propose that should possibly take place because, again, I can't give you specific...
you said you're not the expert.
Well, right. Exactly. This is why I'm saying, and I'm about to, I was just about to say it, and you pulled it right out of my mouth, and right. I'm happy you said that. So that's the fact there. I'm not the expert, and we're right. still in discussions where okay. that's concerned, because there's a lot of dynamics involved. Mm-hmm. But we have seen within discussion that we can have the TTPS somewhat clean and clear of corruption or rogue police officers between a 6 month to a 9 month period.
I wishful thinking.
It is wishful thinking, yeah. But we have seen
it's not gonna
certain,
happen.
We have seen certain mechanisms, and again, I can't give all the information because I myself don't have all the information where the mechanism
okay.
works.
Okay, what aspect of that mechanism that you saw that convinced you, Anthony DeFore, that can happen within a 6 to 8 months? Don't go through the details, but one piece of that mechanism that convinced you that what you had just said to the world, that within 6 to 9 months or so, you would see that happening. What did they say to you that convinced you?
Well, one thing that that somewhat made me feel good about the chances of us having a very good chance in cleaning up the security services really is a vetting process. And again, this vetting process would entail intel of sorts, historical intel. And again, you know, you have people that are wanting to hide certain things. But remember, when we sit down and look at what is going on in the first world and the technologies that they have with DNA evidence and all these different types of next level 21st
do you
century.
Do you know, my estimation?
Tell me.
From on the ground, looking at how things happen, do you know, I say 9.5 police corrupt. 9.5 out of 10 are them corrupt.
Yeah. So it's a screws on the whole station.
No, but that's the thing. Forcibly corrupt.
Some of them are?
Forcibly corrupt.
Exactly. Yes,
correct.
Exactly.
Because of superiority.
Exactly. Alright? How the hell are you going to deal with that?
No, again.
How are you going to deal with that? Watch me.
Forcibly. Let me ask you something, God.
Yes.
So if the superintendent in a police station shows up again, we're now going to require them to declare their assets as well as constantly surveil their assets, coupled with the polygraph testing. If they could pass all of that, wouldn't you be convinced that they are a clean cop?
If they could pass all of that?
Yeah. Yes. If they are declaring their assets upon getting the job, they will be constantly surveilled of their assets, right? Hmm. As well as mandatory polygraph testing, especially for somebody in such a superior position. Wouldn't that be enough to convince you that once they pass those,
them going on cover up, them
they'll cover up the actual test, but all in the test and all that.
It's Trinis you're talking about. It's Trinis.
You see this
6 to 9 months thing.
Yeah.
Right. About this thingy. 6 to 9 months about
cleaning up. Well, again, it's not about cleaning up totally. You know, it's identify. It's identify.
All right. That's 7,000 police.
Right.
Right? What are you going to do with them Coast Guard and them who I feel must be more corrupt than the police?
Well, again, they're going to go through the same
and the customer.
All
right. So, Garth, like you said, you need to start from the top. You're not going to take every single Coast Guard on the ground level and put them through that to start with. You start from the top, the superiors, the same thing we were saying. That a lot of them are forcibly corrupted on the ground level. So you start from the top and cleaning up is much easier. If you cut the snake from the head, you can deal with the body after.
All right, but this snake has many heads.
Many heads,
right.
Yes.
Well, let me tell you something,
yes,
right?
Yes.
Now,
I like you too bad.
Now, when you're looking at the country and the economy, how are you all going to deal?
Oh boy, I love this
the
one.
Economy.
The economy, boy, let me tell you.
That is your forte?
Oh boy. Well, it's not my forte.
Are you going to be the Minister of Finance?
It's not my forte, and I ain't really looking to be no Minister of Finance either. But my point is that I'm excited to see the type of proposals that PP wants to put forward to reboot our economic sector, because we do want to invite lots of foreign investment here locally to assist in helping get our people working. We need to circulate cash through the system, because it's as if our arteries are being choked right now. It's why we have the population not happy. But aside from
I don't understand. You just a little earlier you spoke about $60 billion.
$60 billion, and whose pocket is that going?
$60 billion, and who is pocketing? So when more people bring in a certain money, then who is going to pocket? How are you going to ensure that it is shared equally or
again, rebooting the Republic, God. Everything needs
that's
to
a lot
get
of fancy language. Reboot the Republic.
Well, it's something for the in layman terms and as such, because at the end of the day, it's exactly what needs to be done. We need to turn that switch off and restart.
Okay,
we need
so
to
foreign investment. Right.
Foreign investment. Aside from foreign investment, you have shipping that we can do here. We're the best place in the entire Caribbean. We're out of the hurricane chain.
Shipbuilding,
maintenance, storage.
What did they do?
Why didn't do it, God? What's
the
reason?
Out of the hurricane belt, the yachting industry alone.
This is a billion dollar industry. Okay, gentlemen. So you have absolutely no problems with utilizing and implementing great and brilliant ideas from past regimes
that weren't implemented.
The point is that,
or even if they were,
if the idea
even
works,
if the idea works,
why are we going to reinvent the wheel?
Brilliant.
My point is, it's to get the job done. PP wouldn't exist.
I was going to cuss all over this otherwise.
Hold on.
You can't just overlook what seemed to be to work, and just because they didn't do it and it didn't work, you understand?
Oh, you're going reinvent the wheel, God.
But the answer ain't good.
My point is this. God, we would not exist. The PP would not exist if the UNC or the PNM or both parties did what they were supposed to do.
All right. Talking about what they were supposed to do. Mm-hmm. Are you aware that under the 5 years of Kamala Prasad Bisesa, there were an average of 72 less murders.
Wow.
Than when she came in.
Wow.
In 2009, I think it had I think about 485, and the highest amount of murders under her, you had 413. All right. Unless an average of 72 in 5 years. Now, you're not celebrating 413 murders as the least in 5 years, but at least it had to be that they were doing something would have brought down the murders.
No, God.
You say no, explain to me why.
No, God. You can't even try to quantify to say because you come with 60 or 70 people less that day, you're doing so much better. Okay. If you want to say you're doing better, change that number from 500 to 5 people.
Well, you remember, we got to be very realistic.
No, but that can be realistic, God, because if you have a happy population with money in their pocket, not having to try to be a part of gangs or hurt people, kidnap and murder, the point of the matter is we would not have murders, brother. The people dying would be people getting heart attack and stroke.
So you are actually discrediting that achievement of 72 murders.
Yes,
discrediting
personally that. For me, this is not on the party's behalf, on PEP's behalf, this is Anthony Defoe. I do not see any betterment of having 60 some odd people
less.
I am saying if it had, let there be from 500 to 5, let it be from 500 to 100. I think that is proper work to help the population in bringing down crime. The only reason why it was 60-something people less, I think she had emergency for a period.
Yeah, but that was in 2011. It was 300-something. But afterwards, it still went up.
Right.
Christoph, how do you feel about that?
I believe if she did anything of value, it would have continued down the line.
PNM came in after.
What did they change when they came in terms of what she implemented and they changed? Because as far as I see, they implemented what she did with the same anti-gang legislature.
She tried some stuff like a state of emergency.
Right.
She tried.
Right.
Knock it if you want. Not a problem.
Wasn't successful, all right? Right.
She tried. She changed ministers.
Cool.
This guy hasn't done anything.
Right.
He's still there.
Yeah.
She has tried. She came up trying to say, well, let's put soldiers and police together, whether you like it or not. She was trying stuff.
So with the 5 years and the legislative power that she had, don't you think her and everyone else in that parliament knew that to stop crime, we need to close off the borders first? It's like we're trying to sweep the house with all the windows and doors open.
So,
and the sand like storm in Venezuela.
So a PP government is stating categorically to the world tonight on Power 102.1 FM.
Yes, sir.
That in 5 years' time, or you tell me, in what space of time will you reduce? No, you're not talking to jackasses, is it?
Right.
Okay, you're talking to intelligent people.
Of course.
All right? Because you just said that you thought that, you know, what you would appreciate, what you would have appreciated is if they had moved from 500 to 5.
It's an exaggeration, but you get
it. It's an exaggeration, yes.
Okay, fine.
Right,
Now give me, okay, you exaggerated, fine, accept that.
Right.
Not a problem. But give me a realistic figure of a party, a PP party in government, like closing off borders, vetting police and all the
cleaning
stuff.
Up the police,
cleaning up the
service.
Force. Give me and give the world who are listening here, and a lot of PP people listening, tell us what percentage of reduction will we see from a PP government in 5 years?
Well, 5 years.
Saying you get in and it's 500 murders. Realistically, you say from 500 to 5 was an exaggeration.
Right.
Cool. Give us realistically.
Realistically, in my mind, I do believe we can bring that number below half. Below half of what, if you're calling 500, we walk in at 500. I'm saying I am very confident that
after 5 years, it could get about 250.
Boy, if not less. If not
200.
The goal is less.
200.
The goal is less. We don't want one of our citizens dying.
I understand what the goal is.
Right.
The goal is 5.
Correct. I love
the goal
it.
Is 5.
Yes. Right. Yes.
But
and those would be the acts of
right.
The
goal is 5. But I said realistically. Let's not bullshit people.
Yeah, we're not trying
we're
to
dealing
bullshit
with
people.
Real stuff here.
Correct.
Right.
Correct.
All right?
Right.
Realistically, what you think is going to happen, because you're talking big, you know.
Yeah.
Wall around here,
yes.
Police here,
yes.
What you call? Oil rig out in the field,
yes.
3 miles, 30 miles all
yes.
day.
Yes. You have your coast guard, your
thing.
That and
right.
The other.
Right.
Yes.
Right. Right.
Everything getting searched, nothing coming in without knowing what
the
hell is going on.
No, listen to me.
Now,
if you know you're not party officials and you're not giving a figure, don't say anything, because we're going to hold you to it. And we're going to hold your leader to it.
Cool. Well, I am here really to speak on behalf
okay,
of me
fine.
And my barrister.
So, if you know you're not going to say anything, let's jump to something else.
Jump to something else.
Housing.
Jump to
housing.
Something else. Housing.
Housing.
Oh,
all right.
Gosh. Lovely one again.
Housing. Tell me about your housing policy.
Our belief in housing policy, we want to empower all citizens. We've talked to a few foreign companies where they have given us information as far as being able to fabricate homes. That is much better than what's been fabricated for our people for the past 50 plus years for approximately $100,000. Now, when you look at $100,000 at 30 years, no interest, no deposit, you're looking at just over $500 per month. A minimum wage earner can more than afford a home on a minimum wage salary at $500 mortgage. And this is a home that they can be proud of. Again, we need
what
to...
What size of home is it?
Well, you're looking at it, probably a two-bedroom. You look at it, you know, it's not a large home. It's a
what
starter
size?
Home. It's a starter home. I can't give you dimensions right now.
Right. But I think someone was saying something about a 20 by 20.
No, it's not a 20 by 20. This is no ice cream house. This is not NHJ you're dealing with. This is the Progressive Empowerment Party.
And
we want to empower people.
What's
to,
the value of the house?
$100,000. TT dollars.
$100,000
TT dollars. And on a 30-year mortgage with no deposit and no interest, this is your first home, eh? This is first-time homeowners as a minimum wage earner. What we propose is that we open the banking sector where you get financing.
for up to... How banker you feel about... Well, again, bankers are on your side?
Well, hold on, wait.
Your finances are bankers.
Hold on, brother, because the banking sector, we have a session for them too, you know, because we have to revamp that. That in a mess. That is a mess. They are predators in paradise, brother, because you being robbed by men in a suit and AC. That's what's going on there, you know, brother. You understand? So you have two choices. Either you get robbed on the road with a man and a mask, take your purse and money. But here what's going on, we don't like that. So why not simply go in a bank?
What's your policies on education?
On education?
Oh.
That's a lot as well.
That is, boy.
So...
Get rid of the SEA. Get rid of it.
To start.
Waste that time. Right.
You shouldn't have a battle to be placed in a secondary school.
That is ridiculous.
As well as you shouldn't have prestige schools versus non-prestige schools that doom over 90% of the students that come out of the SEA to mediocrity.
Gentlemen.
All schools, prestige schools.
Gentlemen.
That's the goal.
How are you going to come up against the religious bodies?
Against the religious bodies.
To deal with what? With the religious body trying to what? Hold back our other citizens from getting the same...
How are you going to do that?
Zoning schools.
It's not even zoning schools.
So what about the Concordat with them getting 20% because of their...
No, we're doing a GPA. It's a GPA model. And we're revamping the actual... What the students learn, what they give for the
students.
So what
laptops in school?
Of course.
Are you going to give them?
Of course. It's not even a matter of laptop. They may not even need laptops because we're in the 21st century, Garth. Why are we using black and white boards? Why are we still using that? Why don't we have a big, large screen? You have it in each classroom.
So
and you can have...
Wait, hold on.
And you have the top teacher in the world teaching all your students all at the same time. And the people who are supposedly teachers right now, they are... You have them as... They're basically in the classroom guiding the children. If you have a child that might be falling behind, being able to identify the children that need more help. My point is that the system that we're proposing is a GPA system. We're able to track the student, the teacher, the principal. With that, we can look at the constituency.
Wait for a second. Mm. Are you all going to reduce our qualified teachers to just becoming monitors or something?
No. Our teachers will get reformed. They will get updated 21st century.
But you just said that we'll have the current teachers in the class just monitoring some of that.
Well, again, just a part of the system that we're putting in place. It's not to say the teachers are going to be derelict.
You all are going to come in. You all are proposing radical change. You know you're going to get a lot of fight.
Right.
Do you think you're going too radical?
Why do you think we're going to get a lot of fight, Garth?
No, let me wait a minute. Because the system.
Because of the system?
Yeah, because...
But if you were to break everything down, step by step, and showing a foolproof system, who is going to go against that?
The same people who are going against you right now.
Which is the oligarchy, the one percenters,
the people who are benefiting from the system now.
Of course.
Because the majority of people benefit from the system, they are the owners and managers
of the system. How are you going to break that?
They can be the owners of whatever they want to be the owners of. That's their prerogative. The point is, we want 1.4 million people to know what their right is and what can be possible for them. They have an institution, a political vehicle that's new, that is real, forward-thinking and progressive. And let me tell you something, all the critical thinking you see happening here, this is to bring Trinidad and Tobago to a first world status. This is not about it being a dream and we have to look to 2030 and all of this madness. The point of the matter is that we've identified everybody on the ground here in Trinidad knows what's wrong, knows what's broken and where it's broken. And the point is the PP is putting in the public space proposals in order to fix these things legitimately.
What's your plan for community development?
Oh, well, again, this is where we're starting from local government. That's why we're inserting people within local government, because we want to be close to the community. And again, you said before, we started this show before, which you're saying, you know, local government have no power, it have no this, it have no that. But PEP getting into office, let me tell you, local government will have teeth. People within local government will be able to have a level of power in order to help the people that they are there to serve and help.
How are you going to ensure that they help them?
Again, it's all about reform, God. It's all about reform. Our laws need to be reformed. We need to go back to the Constitution, brother. Every creed and race finds an equal place. Let's start there.
right? Because we have to look around us. We have a large portion of our population living below the poverty level. We wonder why the country is going into chaos. The point of the matter is if we are able to fix the community, we could fix the constituency. If we fix the constituency, we're fixing the nation. Because the
when
point
are you
is
going to bring out your policy document?
Policy document, I'm hoping. No. That's just the policies at a glance.
Right.
Our policy document, I'm hoping that should be completed, if not already. But I'm not sure. I'm not going to say
right.
that for fact, because I don't know.
Right.
Our PRO, Ms. Creaky, should be able to give you some information or insight on that.
Because,
on the notice.
Because we need to see a policy document so that we
of
can
course.
Critique it.
Of course. Right. We want the population to critique it. We want them to know for fact
because
and ask
a lot of
the
stuff,
questions.
A lot of stuff sounding
I know out there it's
kinda idealistic.
Yeah, and again that's because you see we are so jaded as a people. We think that this is so far out and far reach. We should not think that way. Singapore is got our their independence the same time as
no,
ours.
No, I mean I think when you see things like those you're kinda you know beat us down in a sense as though you know we are you know, feel that that's so unattainable and stuff is not that. It's not that we believe it's unattainable.
Tell me.
You know, we have heard a lot of stuff like that before.
Right.
And we don't trust politicians.
Of course.
With their fancy speeches.
But you're right. Absolutely correct.
You know, and their fancy glossy paper.
But my point to you,
you
Gar,
understand.
Yeah. We are not politicians.
We are not of the political cloth.
And they all
say that.
Am I a politician?
And they all say that. Well, I think you are.
I have no
you
need. I don't want.
I mean,
Based on what? And
I don't know why you should run away from it because politics is a science of government.
Right.
It's just that these thieves. And robbers
yes.
give it a bad name.
That's right. That's
you know?
Right.
So we are looking on.
We need you to look on.
For whom reasoning
and aside
is part,
from looking on.
Reasoning is part of our daily operations. We say, let us hear what you have to say, and then we decide.
Right.
And there are some of us who go further than just looking on. We are directly involved. We do stuff. And there are many of us out there. And pretty talk and fancy talk and idealism is not going to fool us. We want to see practical stuff taking place and we want to test your policies.
Well, come be a part of
policies.
The party. Come
and
search and yourself
within
the party.
We don't necessarily have to be because a lot of times, you know, when you become a part of it, of the party, people try to control you. When you disagree with some of the stuff, people say all sorts of things against you. And people don't appreciate that kind of stuff. So people rather just, stay out, look on, be interested, and,
You know what you just described there?
What's that?
Old politics.
Correct.
Well, it might be, but the reality is, when you get burned,
of course, and
when
that's
you
understood,
get
it,
when
right.
you get burned so many times, what do? You try to protect yourself.
That's right.
Right.
That's right.
And
correct,
protect
right.
your family and protect your country, so people can see how much old politics it is.
Yeah.
Right.
Even that sounds as a kind of an insult somewhat
yeah,
because
yeah.
people want to know, you could see what the ass you
yeah,
want.
Yeah.
you know
right,
what I'm
yeah.
saying?
Yeah,
all right?
It's true.
So in terms of him calling it old politics, I was doing some soul searching in terms of political direction. I went to the Monday night forum, sat there, listened carefully, thought of my questions, which question is the most burning to be asked. Waited, not an opportunity to ask it. Same thing with the PNM. From the first meeting and every other meeting that I attended with the Progressive Empowerment Party, there was always an opportunity to ask my questions and to present my point of view.
Just take a pin. We need to get the callers in on the conversation.
Oh,
to talk, 222-8255, 612-TALK, 612-8255. You can get in on the conversation. We have the candidate for the July 16th by-election, Christoph. Christoph Samlal, and in studio we also have Anthony Defoe. He is the campaign manager for Christoph, and he's also the media or one of the media directors, and we have some calls in the line already. Hello, hello, good evening.
Good afternoon, good night, Dad,
yes,
and to the two gentlemen there.
Good night, sir. How are you good?
I have a question for you.
Yes.
Everybody seems to be wanting polygraph tests for police, for teacher, for everybody except the politicians. I would want to ask you, before the election, if you as a politician would be willing, together with your leader, to take a polygraph test.
Yes.
Definitely. I'll listen up here.
Yes, we will. We are willing. Definitely. And we pose that same question to our counterparts. And again, I would love to see the result of that.
Hello, good evening.
Hello.
Yes, good evening.
Good night, good night.
Oi.
Famo.
Yes, I'm Famo.
Hey, this is the same party with Philip Alexander.
Yes, it is.
Okay, I want to tell you something and then I'll ask that question, right? No, one is that I realize young people really like on Philip Alexander after say like on his Facebook or YouTube, because I hear my son, who's a young fella, and every young people are not interested in new politics. But Philip, somehow the young people gravitate into Philip Alexander on his messages and things. They like him. No, what I am thinking is, let's face it, it's PNN, UNC, and then we have a racial thing. And you or your people going up for election going to have to face this thing going on, which will really stymie all your good message. I think, I don't know how well to stand with it, but I feel all you have to get together with one of those parties, and I don't believe it should be PNN.
No.
Mm-mm. And what I think you should do is the clan will have an arrangement, an agreement that they're not going up in the area that you're going up, so that you could afford to get your suit. And the idea that you have that the young people gravitating to, make a deal and assign basis a memorandum or whatever of understanding that you must, if you get in power, you must bring these things, because the young people really like what they hear. But I mean, let's face it, you're meeting something there that you really have to be flexible. I don't know what you think about that. And one more thing. What about having commissioners? Instead of like this problem with this one commissioner of police, they're trying to get there. Why we don't have a commissioner of police on southern side, eastern side, and northern side? I've heard somebody talk about that, and it makes plenty sense. You go in the States and even Europe, I see they have something like that. And listen.
Thank you very much.
Well, Paula, I thank you a whole lot for your contribution. I'll tell you, first of all, we have no desire whatsoever to partner with the UNC or the PNM, because the problem of Trinidad and Tobago's politics has stemmed from them, basically. All the issues we're dealing with, all the non-accountability and transparency that the population is dealing with has been initiated by these two said parties. They have none. At any point in time, not even when Pandey was in office, he had the opportunity to make changes and create reform, and he's talking about that now. Why talk about it now when you had the opportunity to do it back then? I mean, there were several opportunities for us to have proper recall in Trinidad and Tobago, and the point of the matter is PNM nor UNC or any other administration.
So you're not going to join up with anybody?
No, nobody at all.
Before
PNM and UNC, we have no desire whatsoever.
Well, it's not nobody else, no.
Well,
right. It's not
exactly.
Nobody else.
So again,
all is the third force.
That's it.
PP is the third force.
All right. Third force is the first force, is the one choice.
Come on, man, again, like, be realistic now.
No, understand
what I'm saying. You're saying that
PP is not no first force. What's that?
Are you implying that votes belong to the UNC and the PNM?
But of course, votes belong to them.
Really?
For
Why?
Years,
Why?
They've been getting
Why?
Votes.
Why?
Because all those
votes
in a certain place for years. It belonged to them.
And what qualifies it to be belonging to them? Because
race.
Exactly.
Ah, boy.
Race.
Exactly. Yes. Yes. And to the caller, you talk about how are we
so
going to deal with the race issue. The point of the matter is that we stand by our anthem. Every creed and race finds an equal place. And we're going to sing that song till death do us part. That's the bottom line.
We have some callers on the line. Let's
but yeah, yeah. But we will come back to that.
Yeah,
we,
and the four commissioners. And the four East, West, North, South commissioners.
I like that too.
Hello.
What? Actually, I had one thing because he was asking.
All right, hold on a second, Kingy. Sorry, yeah, quickly.
Yeah, he was asking about why the young people gravitate towards Philip so much. I'm 25, being the candidate for Barataria. I am the young people he's referring to. And the thing that attracted me to Philip the most was twofold. One, he spoke what I've been thinking about Trinidad politics and wondering why nobody else brought it up. As well, he was raw in his truth.
All right. Some people think a bit too raw, but we will talk about that. Hello, good evening.
Good evening to you, Gat, and good evening to the guests on the mini studio there.
Good evening, good evening.
And Gat, wow. Gat, you now answer a question there by telling the candidate and the person next to the candidate there that the votes belongs to the PNM and belongs to the UNC.
Mm-hmm.
They're so true. It would take 10 to 50 years to see a third party force in this country. Because we do not trust no third party in this country. We have to be talking constitution reform. That party cannot talk about moving Rowdy, moving Tamala, and the system remain the same. The only how I will support a third force party in this country. They're talking about constitution reform, filling the gaps of the repose in this country.
Yes.
We know what third party does do in this country. Not today, not tomorrow. Read the history and the facts there to show it. Third party split the vote. And we want to know what is that party agenda. What is the only party agenda? Because only a leader say on Facebook he do not want to be no prime minister and we don't bump to vote for him. He use the F word too. So how we don't have a leader like that going on Facebook and cussing women, cussing the public leaders for people who do not want office. You can't want office. And going on Facebook and using 30 words on this country and expect this country to support a third force. I am saying this country must reject our third force because third force is the games. Because we understand what COP do we understand what ILP do us. So why are you coming this evening here? We try to talk nice talk and only have this policy. We have to change the system and tell. We're talking about constitutional reform because nice talk will talk. But if we're in talk constitutional reform to change the loopholes where the big boys and the big girls have an easy way in this country, I do not want to take force. We reject it because this country is a two-system party, UNC, OPNM.
Yeah.
We give COP six seats in this country. We also give NRL a chance. What they do.
Alright.
We are saying that all third force party, they split the vote in this country.
Thank you very much. Point
well. I want to be brave too. The vote belongs to the PNM.
Thank you very much. Point well taken. Hello, good evening.
Well, but
when you come back on.
Hello. Hello, good evening.
Right, so in terms of him asking what's the difference between this party and previous third forces, no recycled politicians is the difference. Nobody who had previous affiliations with previous administrations to, like he says, swing the votes or split the votes. That's the difference between us. None of us ever represented any other administration before.
Yeah, but what, did your leader represent any political party before?
Well, he went independently in 2015 and he had a little stint with COP thinking that they were the third force that we are trying to build today.
And the AOI or something like that? And he had a third force with Nicole Dyer, Griffith and Day and stuff like that. And
third
then
force
that.
Movement, I think.
Yeah,
it was.
Something of the sort. Right. Yeah? Hello, good evening. Hello? Turn your radio down. Listen to us on your phone. Hello?
Next
caller. Hello, good evening.
Hello?
Yes, good evening.
Hi, Quinn?
Yes, go ahead.
Hey, that I want to be sure.
Yes.
A boy, old Korean like me, who does vote more than the young people. We ain't voting for you if you have that attitude right now, you know. You have, let me tell you something, I like all that, you know. Let me tell you, see where all that saying, all that just win with no PNM or no UNC and that rigid thinking. But boy, more old people have voted for vote than young people. And I'm telling you, if you have lime, you have to make lime juice. And all you have to start somewhere, my friend, take this stupid advice. Or let's start something. I mean, all they have good ideas, and all they think that all they want to be with nobody else, but they go take 100 years in this country if you feel you could do it alone.
All right,
and
thank you.
I'm telling you because I wouldn't vote on it.
Thank you very much. Point well taken. Hello, good evening. Hello.
Hello, good evening.
Yes, good evening. Go ahead.
God.
Yes.
You hearing me?
Yes, loud and clear. You go right ahead. Hello?
This is Philip Alexander.
Hey. Philip, okay. You had to come on the set, boy.
I come in on the set, but I just wanted to answer your last two callers and this 10 and 15 and 20 and 100 years to change anything. The Belmont East voter turnout was less than 30%, and Barataria as well. They have a whole 70% of the voters of Trinidad and Tobago that want neither the PNM nor the UNC nor the Bacchanal nor the NOI. Everybody who wants to talk about continuing the same old, will solve nothing. We have no interest in that. And I just wanted to add that to them. And I wanted them to hear us say that. The change must be real change.
That's right.
Not exchange.
That's right.
Talking
right.
About who was in what party. Kamala came out of the NAR. Everybody try and find they was in ULF and Club 88 and UNT. Everybody have to do what they have to do to get to where they need to get to make the change that they want to make. Tony raised an issue just now.
Partner.
We're talking constitution reform and they have no idea what they're talking about. We talk real constitution reform.
Partner.
We talk recall legislation. We
Mr.
talk
Alexander.
Campaign finance.
Mr. Philip Alexander. Don't let me. Mr. Philip Alexander, are you listening?
Yes, sir.
I want you to come in studio. We are no time. You is the man himself. Yeah, but thanks for that.
Lock him down one
thanks
time.
For that. Yeah, we had a time. Thanks for that. When you come in next week, Monday, please, God.
Yes.
Huh?
Yes.
Make it happen. And
you make it happen.
Watch me. It happen. On my part, it happen.
Yeah.
Great. My PRO for me tonight.
Oh, God. You can't pick already, boy. My PRO, boy. All right.
Gentlemen.
Good night. All right. Cool. Night. Thank you, buddy. Next caller. Hello. Good evening. Hello?
Hello, good night, Mr. God, Christopher, and your guest.
Good night, partner. Good night.
Del Montier.
Yes.
You have a very interesting guest. But, you know, he's like a rough diamond. He needs cutting and shaping and polishing. And to come in a situation like this, where you have those two parties, did not just establish like that.
Today.
So to come to have support just like that.
True.
There are two different reasons. I wouldn't go into that now. But what I will try to explain to you is there might be or there is a need for a good vehicle to run this country.
Yes,
a
thank
proper democratic political movement.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
But in order to get that kick started, to overpower the other two into office, first thing have to be done is you have to meet the people, meet the electorate
mm-hmm.
in the 41 constituencies, and you have to hear their ideas to put with your ideas and your executive ideas, and you have to form a mass movement.
Mm-hmm.
You don't need a few hundred or a few votes to take over this country.
Thank you very much, caller. You get a point.
So what you have to do is, as long as you're not doing what Abu Bakr plan to do.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
We ain't going so extreme at all.
Yes, gentlemen. I mean, we have some calls in the line, but okay, we'll just take that one and let's get our yeah. guest in.
Because I want to still respond to, sure. to a couple of those.
Okay, after this one, all right? Hello, good evening.
Hello, good evening.
Yes.
I'd like to know what the party's ideas are on reform in terms of firearm users' licenses. Because I am of the opinion that once you are 21 years old, of sound mind, and in gainful employment, you should be able to own a legal firearm. All right. Any party who has my ear on that issue, I would vote for them. Because we need to be able to protect ourselves.
Right.
You don't need reform for that, brother.
Thank you, caller. Thank you. Yes. Gentlemen?
Yeah, I was saying, you don't need reform for that. We actually have that in place already, where you go, you have the police come home to your house, check out where you're going to have the gun, make sure it's safe. You need to go for physical and mental evaluation. It's a whole long, lengthy process to apply for a firearm user's license. What is the problem right now? is that that bottlenecks to having to either be approved or denied by the commissioner of police, like y'all were asking. And that is where the bottleneck occurs. So as far as we know, there's about 7,000 firearm user applications who went through the same process to show that they are sound of mind and physical ability. That just has not been approved or denied because, again, corruption.
Just
some people get, and the rest who don't have that extra push or that extra link, they remain with the other 7,000.
Yeah.
Okay. So we don't
need
reform.
So let's deal with the police commissioner thing that you see you like.
The police commissioner thing I said I like.
Yeah, the East, West, North, and South Police Commissioner.
Oh, okay, you want to come back to that? I actually was on the callers before,
Okay, go ahead. Yeah, okay,
you throw me off there, man. Right, God, where's that one?
Okay, go ahead and talk with him.
No, I just want to say, basically the same as what Philip was mentioning before. We, number one, cannot align ourselves because the problem is those said parties, and that's the bottom line. And like he said before, the electorate that's been actually putting these institutions in place in the parliament is approximately 30% of the voting public. So you know, you're talking a 70% of the a portion of the public that is not voting. Now these are the people that we are trying to reach out to. These are the people that we are trying to get the information out, and it's only in very recent times that we've been exposed, basically. In fact, it's been today has been the first real day from mainstream media that the PP have gotten any type of exposure in letting the population know what we are putting, that well, aside from being a third force, just that there's another player on the block. It's that simple. And you're talking about a party that has been in existence just over a year, that has been able for local elections to put two candidates in place. Is there any other party in the history of Trinidad and Tobago being able to do that?
So
that in itself shows the seriousness of the party in itself and where we would like to take this country, because we can't wait any longer, Trinidad and Tobago. No matter how much we want to talk about tribalistic politics, who is PNM and who is UNC and who is old, who is grassroots and all of this madness, at the end of the day, Trinidad and Tobago, sit, open your window and look outside. That's all I'm saying. Open your window and look outside. This country is not the country that Trinidadians are supposed to have. And when we sit and look and talk about tribalism, where politics is concerned, who is PNM and UNC and all of this, my point is that you're saying we're gravitating, having the younger people gravitate. Yes, we're having the younger people gravitate. And guess what? The younger people actually outweigh the so-called grassroots that we're talking about
you're
as well.
You're saying that out of an electorate of 100%, 30%...
Is it there?
Is the
turnout right
for
now?
So if when all the figures come in, all the numbers come in, there is no tick upward, what would you say?
As in voters being
as
able
to...
As
in voter turnout, no tick upward.
Well, again, you are putting a forecast in motion there, and I cannot comment on that because, again, I am not the executive, I'm not the leader of the party, and again, there are systems and mechanisms.
So,
won't
you say
that
your message is not gravitating to your message? Because if the customary turnout is 30%,
right,
and that remains
30%,
right,
then what will you say?
But the question is it the 30% for the PNM UNC or is it for PEP?
At the end of the day, 30% is the custom. All right.
Right.
And 30% came out.
Right.
Then what would you say? Did you affect the turnout at all? 30% is 30%.
Correct.
Right.
Correct. And there would not have been a direct effect. We would have been... The question is the 30% that actually voted, was it recurring voters or is it new people that's voting to make up that 30%? That's the question. Again, you're putting our information out there where there's a lot of census information that you have to get in order to determine what that answer needs to be.
So in terms of the 30%, I spent a long time just pondering, why is this figure, you know, why 30%, why such a small figure? And the two reasons I came up with is, one, people don't understand what local government means to them. So they don't feel the need or the desire to put their voice into that.
Right.
as well as people don't agree with the options they have. That's the only two reasons I could come up with that 70% don't come out and vote, because they don't know. Right? They don't know what it means to them, and there's a reason for that. The administrations who ran before chose to leave them in the dark about what this job really entails. They have their grassroots, as we keep calling them tonight, that just go and support when they hear, yo, come and vote PNM July 16th. That's all they need to know. They still don't even know what they put in a position for. They don't know what that person's job entails. And they purposefully leave that 1,800 that comes out and vote for PNM in the dark. The 1,500 that comes out and vote for UNC in the dark. You speak to those people, they don't even know what they're voting for. So what we look for is to educate and inform people on what that vote means to
that
them.
That is it.
And hopefully they use that power.
But aside from educating,
we can't force them to use the power, but we could educate and inform and empower to use that power.
It's all about information, God. The people of Trinidad and Tobago,
so if you put out the information, if you put out the information and it remains 30%.
Well, then that would give me the impression that Trinidad, the other 70%, just don't care about politics.
So you're waiting?
Even when they
don't. You're waiting for this election results to reveal that to your partner?
Well, they didn't have the opportunity to be informed before, so we are going to use our election campaign to push that.
Correct.
To inform them and to let them know, listen, you live in Barataria, this vote, this thing that you're going to dip your finger for, means to you roads, drainage, light. What it really, really, really means
you
to
you think
them.
You're the first of the people coming around informing the people of what local election is all about, my friend?
What the difference is now is the tools we have at hand that the people before didn't have at hand. So before the advent of cell phones and the internet and ease of access to this multitude of information now, which young people use to their advantage now, the older generation depended on newspapers, the TV, and the radio, and that was it. Right? That came with a cost. The internet doesn't, which is why we use that to our advantage, to inform people.
Okay. Tell the people of Barataria why they should vote for Christoph Samlal. Because we are out of time. We just have about 2 minutes. So
see, I'll tell you. I'll tell you.
Well, like you said, the system doesn't work, and the only reason I am here is to give them that voice that I believe they don't have. Because speaking to the people where I live, and like I said, I live in San Juan, Barataria, they don't feel represented by their elected officials, right? So I spent a lot of time dealing with people, understanding their point of view and what they want of their elected officials. And I realized, listen, nobody has given them that option. So I helped build the party with Tony and with Philip and with Felicia and everyone else, helped build the party along those lines. And this was the opportunity to step up to the plate so I can turn it on.
Why should the people give PEP, not just Samlal, but the two candidates and the PEP an opportunity in this election? 30 seconds.
Well, again, we brokering for real change, and you have two people that devoted to the cause and really getting down on the ground, getting dirty, rolling up their sleeves, and really knowing the people within their areas, and for the people to actually know who they are as well. And again, they would be highlighting everything going on within the areas that they have control over, and again, bringing it to the authorities that be in order to bring that type of assistance. And again, the PP is in the mix of things now, and you know, you vote these people in, we are going to inform the population as to step by step what is happening, why it's happening, and for what reason it's happening. And again, it's all about information, God.
Thank you very much. You know, the PNM will not come here.
Why?
The UNC candidate. I went and I walked in Belmont. I was around trying to, and I invited them to say they're coming. Then they say, hey, Monday is the Monday night forum, because I invited them last week. They say it's the Monday night forum after my program here with Felicia.
Yeah.
I went the Monday night forum, I saw them, I invited them again. They say, yes, they're coming. Both candidate and campaign manager, they're not here. The PNM not here, only the PP here. Well, I mean, all they want to now come out and really ting and all they take every opportunity. But I'm disappointed.
Yeah.
You UNC people, I want you who are listening, tell the UNC candidate that she still has another opportunity. Philip is coming on next week, please God. But I will give her an opportunity to still talk. Not with Philip, but she still has an opportunity. I'm not going to call her. I'm not going to call her. Spread the message, you UNC people who heard exactly what I said. Well, this is all for now. I'll see you Monday, please God. Bye-bye.
Okay, go down there and speak a little bit about it. 1 second.